Welcome to Miles of Music. I'm Bob Miles. I'm here with the amazing jazz guitar player live in concert this evening, Chuck Anderson. Chuck.
Pleasure, Bob, as always.
Yeah, as always. Yeah. How are you doing?
Hanging in there.
You look great.
Why, thank you. I'm a shadow of myself.
You are, literally, right? Yeah,
literally.
Yeah. Maybe we'll get into that later in the interview.
We might.
Now, as I listen to you, I've always noticed one thing in particular. You have a very distinct style. I know Chuck Anderson when I hear two notes. Mm-hmm. Why is that, Chuck?
Well, I think probably the biggest reason for it is that as I developed through my career, one thing I didn't do that most guitar players do is I really never emulated anyone. I mean, I never sat down with a record and worked out a Wes Montgomery riff or a Joe Pass riff or whatever. Partly it was kind of a personal thing, kind of a personality thing, and partly it was time. I had so little time in my life that I didn't have literally the time to sit down with a record and transcribe things. So because I wasn't able to borrow from the traditional literature, I really had no recourse except to develop my own. And I would say that's probably the primary reason.
Now, why didn't you have time?
Well, I didn't have time because right from college on, I worked like a maniac, basically. And Well, in music, was always in music, but when I was a junior in college, I was married, I had a son, and I had a house, and then it just got busier from there.
Okay.
So the difficulty of going to school full-time, taking a full academic load at St. Joseph's University, which is where I attended, coupled with teaching maybe 80 students a week, coupled with playing seven nights a week of shows, didn't leave me a lot of time to sit around and contemplate records.
And was music your major?
Music was not my major. There was no music major at St. Joe's, and it was so long ago, so long ago, that there was no guitar majors. There were no jazz guitar majors, and that particular one didn't even have a music major.
Did jazz exist?
Well, no, that was slightly before Louis Armstrong. I just look good for my age.
Yeah, you certainly do. And what age did you start playing?
I started at 14, and first time I ever played was at 14, and I started lessons immediately at 14.
Oh, from whom?
My very first teacher was named Al Colucci, and I studied with Al for 2 years. He recommended that I go to see Dennis Sandoli. I went to Dennis, and I was nowhere near ready for him, so he sent me to a student of his, where I studied another 3 years. And then by age 19, I graduated into studies with Dennis. And then I studied with Dennis from the time I was 19 until I was 28.
Hey, give me a background on Dennis and your lessons, if you will.
Sure. Well, Dennis was a very unusual, some people would say controversial teacher. He really was much less of a guitar teacher than he was a music teacher and a creative teacher. He was really devoted to aesthetics. He really wasn't anywhere near the commercial realm. And of course, that created some trouble for me because I had to make a living. And he was kind of always on me to pursue the artistic side of jazz. And I was always on me to make a living. And those two things were somewhat incompatible. But his approach was a unique literature that he had developed that was in 12 different sections. And each one, we did three things a week across a four-week period. And each thing had something unique in it. By today's standards, or by my standards today, we did very few assignments. We actually only did three things a week, which for me was actually quite small. But the difference was is that we did them to such degree of depth that it took a long time to get them ready. So that's the difference.
And he had some very famous students.
Indeed.
Can you name some?
Yeah, John Coltrane was one of his people. Art Farmer, Pat Martino for a brief period of time, and I think Charlie Parker snuck in there somewhere.
Jim Hall.
Jim Hall for a bit. And some people, you know, did a long-term study like I did, and some people did more consultation. Coltrane was a long-term student, whereas Pat Martino was there very, very briefly.
Okay. Are you happy you studied from Dennis and pursued the artistic side?
Oh, boy. I think I've written blogs and articles on that particular subject as to the controversy and the paradoxical aspect of studying with him. it's odd because in the middle 70s, when I was really pursuing this, my direction was clear. Then I got involved in so many different things, from composition to music production to classical composition, and ran through the bar mitzvahs, weddings, clubs, anything you can imagine, you know. And then it's kind of interesting that now, as I hit whatever twilight period of my career I'm in, right, that I'm now exactly back to where I was when I was 24.
Really?
And did my first album with Al Stauffer and the Chuck Anderson Trio called The Vintage Tracks.
I remember.
Yeah, and it's interesting because I went through a long period of not playing. I didn't play for 20 years, and I devoted myself to composition and education work. And now with some improvements in my health and energy and attitude, I now feel a lot more like I felt when I was 21 or 22. And so now I'm just all into the jazz concert world.
Great. Now let's touch on what we brought up in the very beginning, shadow of yourself. What did you mean by that?
Yes, well, the problem was, without knowing it, and this is what had stopped me from giving concerts, I was suffering from a very severe case of obstructive sleep apnea. Didn't know what it was, I just thought I was tired, which is normal, and nobody knew what it was that far back. They actually estimate that I probably suffered with it for about 20 years, and it got worse and worse and worse and worse, until it finally had lowered my blood oxygen down to 88%, which is just about hospitalization. Mm-hmm. And my metabolism turned off, and I gained 110 pounds.
Oh my gosh.
So since I've handled the sleep apnea and kind of changed my diet and heavily gone back to Mr. America from the gym these days, I've lost that 110 pounds, and I'm kind of back to my, close to my fighting weight.
Okay, that's a good way to put it.
Right.
What did you do in that period? Did you practice or just give it up completely?
Didn't play at all.
Really?
During that period, yes. Okay. I concentrated and devoted myself to teaching, educational research, and composing. Okay. At that time, I spent a lot of time in the traditional music production field, where I wrote themes for TV shows, film scores, jingles, just all kinds of custom writing. So between the composing and the composing the education, that's probably the best way to put it, I devoted all my time to that and devoted no time whatsoever to the instrument. That lasted about 20 years.
Oh, wow. Okay. And I know you write for some very popular magazines. And what are they?
Yes. I'm a columnist for Just Jazz Guitar Magazine out of Atlanta. And I am a columnist for the big jazz website called All About Jazz. And I write a column there called The Art and Science of Jazz. And then I blog for a lot of different places, including some Belgium jazz guitar sites. And also I'll be working with Eric Niemeyer, who has a new magazine. I guess it used to be called Jazz Improvisation.
Right, correct.
And I think
jazz
now it's
improv.
Jazz Improv, that's it. And now I think it's called Jazz Insider.
Jazz Insider.
And we are supposed to start our sojourn soon.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
And your website is?
Mine is www.chuckandersonguitar.com.
Okay, and you have a new CD.
Brand new CD, as a matter of fact. That is called Free Fall. It's the Chuck Anderson Trio, and that's on the Dreambox Media label.
Okay.
And it's coming out today kind of as we speak.
And it's the same trio you're having tonight.
Absolutely. The concert trio is the same trio that was on the recording.
And what can we expect tonight?
You can expect my slogan, audience-friendly, progressive jazz guitar.
Okay.
And by that, we mean that the material is very thematic, and yet it goes pretty far out in the harmonic world and a great deal of interaction and improvisation. And we've planned a program that we think that the people will like, and a lot of people who claim that they don't like jazz do have a tendency to tell us that they like what we play and will relate to what we do.
So it's a little bit commercial.
No, bite your tongue.
Okay.
Bite your tongue. No, it's a little bit artistic.
Oh, wonderful. Okay, well, I look forward to seeing it.
Terrific.
Okay.
We'll look forward to it.
Thanks, John.
See you.